Okay. Hey everybody, Nicole here with CellBotics, and I have Matt with me. He is awesome. Actually, we talk pretty frequently, and I really love what Matt's doing, and I'm so thankful that he is doing a review with me. He came to class 2018, and you know, I was actually training. Tabitha, and then they kind of train the class. I kind of step in and out, but Matt was actually in one of the classes where I was the main trainer. And so it's really been great working with you, Matt. I've actually been to one of your locations in the beginning. I know that I came out there when you had bought a location, right? You bought that location.
Bought a location. I had no idea what I was doing. So right. Right. I knew a lot more after I got out of your class, but I still was. Right.
It was great though. And so Matt is really driven business owner, and he's really focused, and he lives an exciting life. So I just wanted to do an interview with him because I feel like he has a unique perspective on the way that he went about his business. And so Matt, thank you so much for taking the time. You know, I'm really grateful that you're doing this. So sure. I want to start by kind of setting the context. Like what made you think about getting into phone repair? What was your experience, your background? Did you ever fix anything that made you think about doing this?
I used to tinker a little bit, but it was more construction a little bit. But for undergrad, I went to school for mass media communications. Right after school, I moved to New York City and lived for 11 years and worked in crisis PR environment, something totally different than tech. Although I did have Apple as a client, I had Samsung as a client. So I was around the industry a little bit, but it was more on the PR side. After working with journalists and publicists and every corporate communication C-suite you can imagine, I wanted to kind of leave that industry. So I took a year off and really just kind of thought about what I wanted to do. And one of my buddies was going to buy this business. He owns other businesses, but was going to buy it and realized that you had to put a little bit more time than he wanted to allow for it. So I thought about it for 3 or 4 months, purchased the business, and realized I knew nothing about the business. And I needed to, you know, kind of be in a little bit more granular of a level. So I went to CellBotics for 4 or 5 days of training and learned to repair cell phones and really kind of get the intricacies of the business. Although I do not repair phones. The last phones I ever touched were in class. So my perspective is a little bit different, and where that I was lucky enough to hire a bunch of great staff that like some are still with me from some of the first few days, but
oh wow, that's great.
Yeah, so yeah, my perspective is a little bit different than some shop owners of people that have taken it as a hobby.
Right, and that's what I love here, because like I talked to you before we started recording, you know, I love your perspective, because just like me, people think that because I'm the CEO of CellBotics, I fix all types of things. I did once in my life, I fixed everything, right? And sure. I've done all kinds of repairs, but to be honest, I haven't physically fixed anything in over 2 years. And I, you know, I expressed to you that isn't that really the goal to, you know, own a company that it doesn't run itself, but you know, you don't have to be in that seat at that desk and in taking customers for it to be profitable.
Right. And that,
yeah.
And that's, mm-hmm. So that's the kind of thing is, you know, before my last career, I was always at a desk and I was always working. And although I did move to working from home for a while before that was a real thing that people do now anyway, but, right. But I was always tied to the computer nonstop. And my ultimate goal when I did this was to really not that I don't want to work. That's I kind of work every single day, mm-hmm. but if I just want to not come into the office one day, if I just want to go bike riding one day, that, you know, that's the kind of lifestyle that I wanted.
You do live a very unique life though, Matt. You really do. And it's really inspiring because I know you and your wife, you travel a little bit. You lived like on the road for a while here for like, how many months was that?
We only did that for about a month and a half, but no, we went out west for a month and a half trip. But again, that's something that if, you know, in my perspective, yeah. You know, I had great employees and we had one store at that point. We just opened another store, which is slow right now, but we're not even on Google
that's
yet.
That's going to be fixed. Yeah.
But yep. So no, it's already getting great feedback, but yeah. So I really didn't want to live the lifestyle where I had to come in. So although, you know, I take it very seriously and I'm constantly on my computer and phone trying to figure things out and right. Look at margins and things like that, but also wanted to have the flexibility. You know, my wife has been in Mexico for the past month. It's coming back in a week or so. And then we're going to be here for a month. And then we're going to Costa Rica for a month. And I can just work from my computer from there.
I love that. See, and I do know other shop owners and business owners that do the same thing. And I feel like it's an unspoken ability that people are almost afraid to talk about, because it comes off as this, if you're bragging or you're arrogant or you're lazy, you know what I mean? But in reality, that's not what we are. You know, like me, people say, why don't you own multiple retail stores? Well, I do commercial repair now. And with commercial repair, I have a director that manages all that, you know? And right. I actually don't touch it. I walk in there and I may go say hi to the client or have meetings with the CEO of these big depots. And, you know, I may, if my team needs my perspective on a training module, I'll do that. If they really absolutely need me, I'm there. And as you know, and anybody who's watching this, I'm always online. But I can do that from anywhere. And that is my goal. That's why I went into business years ago. That's why I left corporate America. I didn't Right. want to be on a tech bench for the rest of my life, you know? And so I'm glad that you're saying that. And, you know, because I feel like it is an unspoken thing that for some reason we have to be slaves to the business for us to be honorable. And I just feel like that's not what the goal should be. You know what I mean?
Right. And it actually comes down where I feel I probably do work more than I worked yes. before. So that's the yes. thing. It's not like I'm, you know, every day I'm more worried about work and anything. And I'm almost, you know, should I say addicted.
Work day and night, but I might not be sitting in this seat.
Right.
But,
I might you know. Be on, you know, I can sit by the pool and do it. And that was right. the goal. It wasn't to be lazy, because that's probably the farthest thing that I am of anything. I am hyperactive right. in every vertical that there is. But that was kind of the goal, to not be a slave
in
to
one spot. Like, you have to be there. You're not trading your physical movement time for money, right. which is the ultimate goal as a business owner. Now, you are still engulfed in your business. I thought when I quit my job, I said, I'm going to be a business owner because I want to have more time.
No.
But now it's like, it's not even really a job. It's like, it becomes a part of you, right?
It's a healthy obsession, I would call it.
There you go. Yeah. And it becomes like so natural that it doesn't cause effort, and it allows you to have that life, you know, but you still have to work. Like, you work in it every day, but it doesn't, yeah, no. It's not like clock in 9, clock out 5, you know?
Right. No, there's many nights, and especially as I've been opening this last business, that I'm on my computer doing some kind of commercial design or working with a web developer or something, and it's 11 or 12 o'clock at night and it doesn't feel like work.
Me too. Exactly. That's a great example. So, so you took the class, you got the business course, which, how did you feel about that? Since I know you didn't really use the repair. Okay. We know that. What about, which I know it gave you perspective on your technicians and a newfound value for them, right? Learning the repair. What about the business information and all the connections? Cause I think that a lot of people don't understand how much goes into who you know and what you know about the industry as far as your success and ability to have offerings and all that.
Sure. Probably the greatest part about that was that I, you know, I know some about just corporate business and things like that, but I knew nothing about, you know, something in the tech field, and it really just wireframed the business for me. Kind of like, what is important to know? What is important to, like, who to follow? The Facebook page groups, how to flip phones, how all these little things that I just never would have thought of in the world. It kind of just put it in this like one giant package that, yeah, I can unpack at different times and go back to the workbooks and things like that. And, yeah, you know, it was just a tremendous resource and repository, I should say.
Yeah.
For all sorts of information. And yeah, it took something that would probably have taken me a year and mm-hmm. a half to like kind of figure out and fail 10 times. Yeah. Maybe only fail once or just get it.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. And I always compare it to, because people say, oh, well, that's on YouTube. And I say, but if you don't know it exists, how do you search it?
Right. No. Like, one of the best things, I never knew there would be a Facebook group or something like that. You know, right, that's a right. resource. Uh-huh. And then,
yeah. And that's just one thing, you know, that's just one thing in the hundreds of things, you know? And yeah, so that's great. So what do you think was like a struggle for you when you started? Do you have something in your mind that was like one thing that it was really hard for you when you were running this type of business?
Sure. I think it was, you know, being terrified of owning a business of something that I didn't know how to do. As far as the repairs, which granted I could have learned, and but I was so busy doing so many other things trying to build the business that it was probably how to hire people and how to keep a great staff and things like that. Yes. And learning to be more of an advocate and a friend than like a boss, I should say.
Yeah, Oh man, yeah, I think that's so important, especially when it comes to this industry, because you really, your techs are really just like so integrated and so important in your business.
Sure. When you have a business that's like running on this level of, you know, that's always made up of
skill set.
Three or four, yeah, skill sets and limited employees, they become more of a family than like, you know, in fast food or something like that, where right. there's a lot of churn and turnover, I should say. Yeah. That was probably a big part of like kind of learning on that level.
Right. Yeah, of course. I agree. That's like one of the most important things to me is my team. Like I understand their lives. I'm an advocate for them. I support them because I want them. I need them. I want them here on my team. I don't want them going anywhere. Right. So I'm not a victim to them, but I partake in their life and I care about what's happening to them. It's not like, oh, this person was late, I don't want to hear about it, write her up. No, what's wrong?
Right.
You have a flat tire, how can we fix that? I'm your support. I'm there for you now.
Why are you upset today? Not like,
yeah, right. What's wrong? Are you emotional today? What's wrong? Do you need the day off? Do you need to go lay down? Like it's literally, I care about them. So it's very different than like, I had another business before, a bookkeeping business. And it was very like, are you on time? And are you doing your work? Like I didn't look at it that way. But when you get into a business where their skill set is so valuable outside of just like the normal job thingy that you usually base people on, it's like so important that you care about them. And so I guess you're opening a second store, so this has definitely been lucrative. I never ask what people make in videos. I feel like that's very private information. I would never say that about myself. So, but obviously you're open a second location, so everything is going good for you. What are your future plans for repair? Are you just going to keep opening, or you think this is just two? What do you think?
I'm going to give this one 6 months. Okay. See if it's profitable in 6 months. Even though I think it may take a little bit longer, but I think it'll be fine. And then I'm already looking to one more place. And probably after that, three would be as much as I want to juggle.
Right. And do you think that since you bought a business and versus now opening one from the ground up, because I know you like rented the space, you remodeled it and everything. Yeah. What do you think was more cost effective, just buying it outright? Or did you still have to redo a lot of stuff in that space?
It was way more cost effective to build it myself the next time, because I knew exactly. I basically, when I bought this business, after a while realized that they had no computer systems. It was very mom and pop, and it's still somewhat mom and pop, but it's, you know, we kind of revamped everything and from like how we do our hours to how we do payroll to how we do inventory to, you know, everything like that. So yeah. So I kind of bought a business. The only thing that we had was we had a somewhat of a name and a reputation in a space that was well seen and visual. So we were like the only one in town for years that did that. So it did bring in some of that value. Mm-hmm. Although I think knowing what I know now, building it from the ground up would have been much more cost effective.
Yeah, I find that too. I found that to be true too. I built spaces from, and I always look at it like I just need a small space, mm-hmm. not a big, huge one.
That would be a recommendation too. Like
you can good always location,
right?
And small. So then you're saving
your overhead as small as possible, as long as you can, and then go up.
Yeah, because repairs don't take much room to manage all of that. And you can always grow bigger space, but it's hard to get a 5,000 square foot space and then cover from.
If you start to do the math and the retail side of it, it's not going to work out. It's always going to be the repairs typically.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. Those are kind of like bonus items. And so you are in a college town or what's considered a college town, correct?
Sure. Yeah. There's a major university here.
So a lot of people are scared of that. Like, oh, college kids fix their own devices. What is your perspective of being in a college town?
I can always feel when the students are gone that business is down. So
They're not fixing their own stuff.
Yes. I mean, I'm sure there's some are. And then, you know, we always get kind of hyper scared about when, you know, there'll always be like a college project of, you know, the teachers help the student set up the phone business and, you know, but that comes and goes. And it's most people, I feel, or a lot of people want a brick and mortar store that has, you know, a lot of Google reviews and things like that.
It's a trust thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's a trust thing. It's that even that subconscious trust that we don't even know we're thinking about.
Right. Right.
Like, it's like, you're just an individual who rents a space, but if they've seen you as an individual holding tools, oh, no, no, I go with that. And they don't even really know why. They just do. You know what I mean? Like, it's just, you know.
Another example is, you know, in the county over that we just started the new store, there is somebody that's doing it. They're doing it out of their house, but they get terrible reviews. He will argue on Facebook back with customers, which is like one of the most unprofessional things to do.
That's terrible.
You know, screaming back, well, you don't know what you're doing and this and that. And I've already heard from some of the repairs that are starting to come in, like, you know, and granted, he is probably 20 to 30% cheaper than we are, but people just don't feel comfortable going to that. They want to come to
Right. And I never compete with price.
Right.
Because I have so much more to add. That's what people don't understand. You're not going to be the cheapest.
Right. Nobody, and I don't want to be the cheapest.
I don't want to be the cheapest. I wouldn't go where the cheapest food is, the cheapest tire shop.
Right.
Don't, I want something good, value, quality, and that's the customers you want to.
Right. Exactly.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So you have a lot.
For some customers I don't want, and that's okay.
That's perfectly fine. Yeah. You are not going to get every single customer, and that's okay. You're only taking a small sliver of the pie. That's what I try to relate to people. I'm like, stop thinking you have to get everyone. You just need your piece of it. You know what I mean?
Sure.
And you'll be good. Yeah. So one last question. What do you think your best marketing outlet is?
I've used a few, and I was head of a marketing.
Facebook, Google, word of mouth.
In this town, it's probably word of mouth, but as far as like Facebook, I think is great because I can sometimes run an ad or something and I can pivot on that ad instantly, but word of mouth probably in a small town is the biggest. If you're in a large town, I think getting up in Google, you know, climbing those ranks, it's worth to spend it on someone that knows SEO.
Yeah, like SEO or something. Yeah.
And pay attention to your Google reviews. That's probably, actually, I take all that back. Google reviews, because we have like 4.9 average.
That's awesome.
And we're higher than anybody in town. And that's probably, I would say.
Actually. And people are organically leaving them for you. You're not persuading them or like.
Yeah, no, I've had so many people come out. I read your reviews. You had the best in town. I've heard that.
There you go. Yeah. And it's all about how you treat people. But I never offer something for reviews. I don't say, hey, I will.
Right.
I didn't offer you anything. Would you do it? Not, I'm going to give you money or I'm going to give you a discount next time. Because I feel like if I legitimately did a good job and I treated you well and you felt good about it, then you would leave a review if I just asked you, you know? So the thing is to ask. And I never like to trade because I'm also like, that could so backfire on you. You know what I mean? You have to.
The only times that we'll do it is like, you know, people come in and they just need their charging port cleaned out or something like that. Or they
there
just need
to fill
an email and they're like, what do we owe you? And we're like, nothing. Like, oh no. What can we do for you? And they're like,
leave a review. there you go. Yeah. That's a good example. Yeah. Some people actually get in the method of exchanging things, which I understand everybody has their own perception on that. But I feel like if we treat people good enough, then they'll leave you reviews. If you ask them, like, I'll open the device and say, hey, you know, because some people are like, wow, this is so professional. Because a lot of people will say that to us when they walk in. Yeah. Nobody's ever filled out a form with me and sent me a PDF copy. Like, that's never happened. You know what I mean?
Right.
And we'll be like, if you really liked this experience, can you leave a review here? I'll open this for you on your device. Just do the 5 stars and leave it there. Yeah. And it's already open and we're communicating with them and they do it right then and there. You know,
there's some great software out there too, that will, you know,
there is.
Follow up with the software, you know, but you know, it's again, another paid service.
Yeah.
But
you can, the, like the point of sales, some of them, they have a text feature and
yeah,
so there's a lot.
An API in the back end that will, after they check out, if you, you know, depending on what, you know, if you get their email or number, it'll send them kind of a survey that will link them right into.
Yeah. Yeah, it's so many ways that you can get good reviews. Okay, great. Well, thank you so much, Matt. I really appreciate your time. And I'm pretty sure this was really informative for everybody watching. Have a great day.
I appreciate it. Thanks so much.